And it's great to have you here with us this morning. And I want to read to us from Psalm 34. It says, "I will praise the Lord at all times. I will constantly speak his praises. I will boast only in the Lord. Let all who are helpless take heart. Come, let us tell of the Lord's greatness. Let us exalt his name together. I prayed to the Lord and he answered me. He freed me from all my fears. Those who look to him for help will be radiant with joy, and no shadow of shame will darken their faces." And I think we can all agree that our world is increasingly fragile and uncertain. But one thing that we can hold on to is the Lord's faithfulness with us. And he's with us in the good times and in the bad times. He remains the same. And he is always worthy of our praise, no matter what's going on around us. And we get to do that this morning together. So let's make a joyful sound to him and praise his name and give him the glory that he deserves.
Thank you. To do the same thing for me. just want us to stay in this moment. We just sung this beautiful song about God being the same God for thousands of years, for millennia. And we're in this series on prayer. And I'd love us to take a moment before we enter a time of communion to say a prayer that generations upon generations upon generations have prayed for thousands of years, and it has been passed down from Jesus himself to us. I just want you to pray that Lord's Prayer, any version that you know. And if you are new to this journey of faith, just feel free to listen to these historic words that have been passed down to us. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Kingdom, the power and the glory. Amen. Never. Amen. Please take your seats. That is definitely one of my absolute favorite songs. And last night when I was sort of mulling over in my head what to say and also trying to decide whether my hair was straight or curly, I still haven't got a verdict on that, but I was trying to ask God, what do I say? What do I say about this moment in time that was so massive? Like, I can't comprehend how huge that sacrifice was, and yet we remember it with bread and juice. So simple. And I just felt inside me God saying, well, that's the point. It's simple. You won't comprehend, our minds are human. We can't comprehend the magnitude, the power, the depth of love that God has for us. And yet it's simple. God made you. God loves you. God gave up everything for you. Doesn't want it to be complicated. We complicate it. Choose me, he says. Follow me, he says. Remember me, he says. For those of you who walked in today and it was complicated, we're carrying things, we've got baggage, we're incomplete, imperfect humans, we're complicated. Take this moment for it to be simple. Take this bread and we remember the body that was broken for our salvation. We drink this juice and we remember the blood that was spilt because of his love for us. It is simple. It is huge, but it is simple. Let's join in this time together. Amen. Thank you.
is one who is greater. Nothing else compares. He holds all power. He holds it all. In the earth and the heavens, does anyone compare how God he reigns? Oh, he reigns. We stand and sing now to God.
God, you are faithful, you are trustworthy, you are true. And we let you have control. We give you praise in this place today, God. And we say thank you. We say thank you for who you are.
Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you like to be seated?
Good morning, church. Please turn to the people next to you. For those online, turn to the person on the couch or in the online chat and please say, good morning. Fantastic, fantastic. Now we've all welcomed each other. Hello, my name is Jessie and I feel so privileged and blessed to be here with you today at our wonderful church. Now brings us time to a time of giving, and what an amazing example our worship and tech team do to show what happens when we give of our time. But also, God does incredible things with our finances. He uses every last bit to do immeasurably more than we could ever imagine. So in this time of giving, before you give of your finances or give of your time, just say a little prayer over it, that it will do immeasurably more than we could ever envision. There are a number of ways that we can give here at Door of Hope, and those will likely be up on the screens. But otherwise, if you have bought a physical gift in this morning, I am going to go with lavender. There is a lavender box at the back for you to put that physical gift in, or else there is some more information if you want to scan the QR code. But please, please don't set and forget. Please pray over that for what God will do. Now, we are in this incredible series around prayer, and we heard last week from Christy, and today we're going to hear from Craig. But before we do, we're going to hear from one of our Connect groups. If you were here last week, they shared with us a little bit about this incredible book that they're journeying through, Praying Like Monks, Living Like Fools. So we're going to hear from them now as they share from their learning through this book, and then we'll welcome Craig. Thanks.
I really enjoyed the book, and I believe it is a great book for people coming into the church to learn how to pray, and just coming as you are. Mm-hmm. Come as you are, mm-hmm. with your brokenness, your pain, and the forgiveness that the Lord has. And it's daily prayer, it's waking up. And with the monks, they get up at early hours in the morning and they start from there and they go on throughout the day praying and listening to the Lord. And sometimes I read this book in adoration when I do go, and it's wonderful. It's just teaching me more and more, praying from morning through to night. All right, I do my duties, but you can pray when you're doing your dishes. Yes. You can pray when you're vacuuming, and just giving him the time and not scraps anymore as I used to. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Talk to me about adoration, because you said something about adoring reading the book.
Yes, you just pray, but talking to him, reading his word, but spending that quiet time for 1 hour. And it's a disciplined life, and that's what I feel coming, is a disciplined life for prayer, because without it, and without being in a community, you tend to go down and down and down, and you cannot do this by yourself. And the Lord sends you to places where you possibly couldn't imagine, and he sends the right people in your life to uplift you and to carry you through your journey.
Thank you. One of my biggest fears was not being able to pray, like sound professional when you pray. That was a big fear, and I think a lot of people don't pray because they feel that fear of being silent and open.
And the other thing was, it said the chapter on stillness, it's not about us. It's about coming to the Lord and emptying ourselves and being available, which was so important. And I think once you learn to shut your mouth, it's very, very interesting what the Lord can tell you.
Absolutely.
How good was that, eh? I can't believe all the little touch points that they got in there. Well, welcome everyone here this morning, and for those online, it's great to be here. And I guess if we're going to talk about prayer, maybe that's a good place to start. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I just want to thank you for the chance that we get to come here and do this in community. We get to do it in person, online. And Father, I pray that you would speak to each one of us, myself included, as we move this time through this time together. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, do your shoulders slump? Does your stomach twist? Do your knees buckle when your prayer life gets compared to a great intercessor? Well, I've got to tell you, mine do. I am just a fellow struggler like you. I always find when someone gives you a sermon topic, it's usually humorous. So today, I hope that as we journey, I get as much out of this as you do. Intercession. Great example, just the other day. I've been trying to get my mother booked into respite from tomorrow since February. The last time I did it in 5 days' notice. It was sort of an urgent thing, and we got it. This time we went through every nursing home in Launceston. Nothing. And I was sharing this with Jenny Gardam, and Jenny said, oh, would you like me to put it on the prayer chain? I said, yeah, yes, please. So straight away, out with the phone. The next day, I got a phone call saying, guess what? And that was the deadline. That day was the deadline for me to cancel my airfares, because I couldn't go and leave Mum alone. And I got a call saying, well, guess what? The last one's come through. And the lady was as excited as I was. I think she didn't want to face that phone call with me. And I just walked up past Jenny and went, and she knew exactly what it was, and she went on and let everyone know. And then on the Sunday, I had all these people coming out and saying, how good is that? And it's community. So what does it mean to be an intercessor? Dictionary simply says this: one who intervenes on behalf of another, especially in prayer. That boils it down nicely, doesn't it? Great intercessors. No, it means someone, anybody, who intervenes on behalf of another person, particularly in prayer. Tyler Stanton, in his book that Jess held up before and saved me doing that, Praying Like Monks, Living Like Fools, says that intercession is for everyone. Intercession is for everyone. It is ordinary love combined with sober humility. It's just ordinary love combined with a sober humility. And Jesus points to this position in humility in the verses that lead up to the prayer that we've been working through over these weeks. And in Matthew 6, 5 and 7, Jesus says, and whenever you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues or at the street corners so that they can be seen by others. Truly, I tell you, they have received their reward. But whenever you pray, go into your room, shut your door, and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. When you are praying, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard because of their many words. So, there is no spectacular involved in being an intercessor. In fact, it's the opposite, Jesus says. Jesus says this is a private deal with you and him. How do we feel about praying for others now? If I was to say to you, you are an intercessor or you can be an intercessor, can we do it? Thanks for that one. Christy, you're the leader. You should have said, well done. She's up to her task. Can we do this?
Yes.
And online, I'm sure you said yes. But do we have time? Ah, we've always got to have a little excuse, haven't we? I play golf. I'm a master of excuses. So many of us do lead busy lives, but instead of ignoring that, we need to embrace that and just see it honestly. How can we be an intervener? How can we be an intercessor? Rick Warren, an accomplished pastor and author, says, if you haven't got enough time to do God's business, it's not a time issue, it's a management issue. Ouch. It's not a time issue, it's a management issue. He says, God won't ask us to do something we're not capable of doing. He may ask us to stop doing some of the things we're doing in order to do the God things that he would like. How unfair is that? Facebook, TikTok, TokFlip, whatever. Netflix, KO, golf, fishing, cars, gardening. How rude is that? You know, Jesus was no less busy. We tend to think that all he had to do all day was just wander along with his disciples, just talking, kicking the dust. We have no idea of the pressure he was under unless you hone in on some of those pieces in the Bible where the throngs were pressing in, constantly wanting this, wanting that, wanting something else. He lived a busy life. We just don't read it that way. In the early part of the New Testament, we see many, many places in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John of where his life was so pressured that he had to take extraordinary lengths to get time to get and pray with his Father. And in Mark, we read of one of these occasions, the last occasion that's recorded. And it says, they went to the place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, sit here while I pray. He took with him Peter and James and John and began to be distressed and agitated. And he said to them, my soul is deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and keep awake. And going a little further, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. He said, Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. Remove this cup from me, yet not my will, not what I want, but what you want. It's a great example of making time and modelling what he taught. Not my way, Lord, but your way. You know, thankfully, late nights and early mornings aren't the only time that we can be interceding. Could we pray when we have a coffee, when we chill with a cup of tea? Could we pray in our lunch break? What about the toilet? Come on, be honest. Who's prayed on the toilet? And do you have that moment where it feels awkward? And then you go, God, it's better than I'm talking to you now than not talking at all. In the shower, I find the shower is a great place. I don't have many vices in life, but hot water and showers is one of them. Trouble is, at my age, a lot of that is now stretching. Before sleep, after sleep, there is time for us to simply intervene into the life of others through God because we love them. Trick question, folks. Do you think that we could find the time to be intercessors? Christy, I'm waiting for you. Yes! Do you think we could find time, people?
Yes.
I think we can too. So what did Jesus teach his disciples to pray? That's interesting, isn't it? Verse 10. May your kingdom come. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So a good question is, what would earth look like if heaven came down and through prayer this world changed? That's a thought, isn't it? Now, I was going to ask you for suggestions and I piked out, I got scared in case I got some really curly ones. So I'll start it off. You know, who remembers watching those beauty pageants? Years ago, probably 20 years ago, they were televised and they would ask this beautiful woman, so what do you want in life? And she'd go, world peace. World peace. There's always the answer. It's like for Christians, God or Jesus is the answer. Well, for them, it's world peace. People of Sydney today would be praying for world peace. People of Palestine are praying for world peace. People in Myanmar, Burma, praying for world peace. Health. If you're not praying for health now, or someone's not praying for you, we all know someone who's praying for health. That world peace comes into our homes, doesn't it? What did they say last week? A woman every 9 days dies in Australia at the hands of a loved or past loved one. How could we change that? Because I'm sure that's not what it's like in heaven. Provision. A home over a person's head. Food to eat that nourishes. There are so many things in this world that would be different if it reflected what heaven is like. And that is a great place to start at praying. But the great end is, but not my way, but your way, Lord. Eugene Peterson, best known for his modern-day translation called The Message, the Bible. But really, he was much more than that. He was a really great modern-day theologian. Says there are three prayer voices. And he says the first voice is the my voice. Remember Nemo? Mine, 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 mine. I want God to work around me. My world, and you come along and do this, do that. This is what I'm doing. Come along board. Hop on the train, God. It's the me voice. It's like treating God like a vending machine or some sort of magic genie that is there with more wishes than three. He says the last voice is the I'm not sure about God voice. It's like the prayer that is so insipid and so vague that God can't help but succeed. It's almost like we're asking him in a non-expectational manner. We're almost disinviting God to be a part of what's going on in our world. But then he says, the real voice is the middle voice. It's the joining voice. It's where we ask to join with what God is already doing. It's not about me. It's not about the God that's almost impotent. It's about saying, God, you are there doing stuff. Help me to join in with what you are already doing. Follow his promptings. God's will, God's way. You know, his kingdom, when we put those things in place, it's sort of like a mighty flowing river. There's no point trying to swim against it. Just jump in and go with it. Could we pray if we treated it like that? Do you think we could put aside our mind voices? Do you think we could maybe get a bit more courage and a bit more faith in what God can do? Do you think we could just simply ask God, what are you doing and where do you want me to go with that? I think as a church we can. I believe we can. I even think I could do that. And I'm sure those listening online could do it as well. Finally, being an intercessor is actually about being in community. Hang on a second. I know Wayne's already gone, but you said that we're supposed to go in our room, lock the door, be quiet, and it's all between us and God. I could see it. He's nodding now. So let me try and explain it like this. I'm using limited words, so the spelling should be okay. Notice a lack of confidence in that. So in any good story, we've got God at the top, closely followed by us down the bottom. So the moment we do this, we've already got community. It's a little hard to see, but there is community. But there's so much more to intercession than that, because we've talked about, well, what's God doing? And we've talked about that it's not about us. Intercession isn't about us, but it's about others. Small piece of board, but you get it. So now that community is growing, isn't it? We've got conversation with God, and we're asking God to work with others. But it's actually more than that. Because you know the funny thing about intercession? When you ask God what he's doing, and he drops something in your heart, it is amazing the number of times it goes from our heart to our hands. I mean, we can pray for world peace, but what does that look like? I know God can do stuff, but God then has a way of turning around and saying, but what are you going to do about it? A great example of that at the moment in the life of this church, and I've asked Danielle and Joel for permission, is the journey that they have been on over the last few months. For those who don't know, Danielle was up here joint worship leading. Joel is our manager of our conference centre. That's good. I didn't write that down, so there, out the door, that one goes. And he was diagnosed with cancer in the pelvic bone a couple of months ago. And there have been many, many people interceding in prayer on the toilet, in the shower, over their cuppa and the tea. And some deep into the night, some early in the morning. And that's all good. But you know, that intercession, that community between us and God, has also moved into people's hands and feet. And there are people who could pay for 20 gardeners to go to their house, but they are getting their hands dirty and going doing the gardening and the lawns for them. Joel told me there was a person in Melbourne who made it their task to take him a good cup of coffee every day that he was in hospital. There are people who have joined the meal train, just trying to take some of the stress and pressure off the household. There are others who have given financially and have blessed them to take the pressure off what has been a time of unexpected financial pressure. You see, intercession is all about community. That's good for even for me. I must have realised I was running short of time. Community between us and God, us and others, God and them. Intercession, people, is not a big deal. It is not a complex problem. It's simply about us allowing God into our lives, saying, what are you up to? Expanding our heart, taking the time to remember and be fueled and to be refired and to be resuggested to, and then letting it work out through our hands and our feet. You know, sometimes that happens when people don't even know it. Like when the surgeon did the two hernias that he had told them he would not do, along with that same operation. There are things that happen in the spiritual that are called miracles. And that is incredible power. And there are things that happen in the practical. That's love. Intercession is all of that, and we do it in community. Let's pray. Father God, thank you. Thank you that you are not high and polluting. You are not beyond reach. You don't ask us to do things that are impossible for us. You just ask us to be available. And Lord God, my prayer is that I would be better at this. And that each of my friends here before me would get better at this. And for those online would get better at this. That we might trust you. That we might believe that you know what needs to be done. And you know how that needs to be done. And that we might be courageous enough to believe that in the miraculous, you can do it. And in the practical, we can join you. Father, we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. So, what do? It's your turn now. So this is what I would like you to do. We're going to take 5 minutes, and that's not going to be a church 5 minutes where you just start and it stops. This will be 5 minutes. And what I would invite each of you and those online is to just come before God and say, God, what are you up to? If we were to bring heaven to earth, what would that look like, God? And then when that first thing comes into your mind, then I want you to start praying into it and have a conversation with God about it. Even if it's something you think you can't do anything about, he might be leading you to be one of those that are praying for the miraculous. He might lead you to pray for the practical. and to be open to what that means for you. So can we just bow now right where you are? There's plenty of time. Let's ask God to speak to us, because he does, and he will. I know he will this morning. And when he does, follow it. Be an intercessor this morning. God, I want to thank you that you have given each of us the ability to be an intercessor for you. I want to thank you that you have given each of us enough time in the day to do that. I want to thank you that you've promised to lead the way and to show us what it means to bring heaven or a taste of it here on earth. And I want to thank you that we get to do that in community. All praise be to you through our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
We're going to sing a song called I've Witnessed It, and it talks about I have witnessed your faithfulness. And I don't know about you, but I have seen that, I have experienced it, I have witnessed it. And I invite you to do a few things while we're singing this, especially if you have not witnessed his faithfulness in something or ever. I invite you to do what Craig just said. Pray. And get other people to pray. And the other thing I want to invite you to do right now is to open your mouth and to sing and to see what God will do. So can you do that with us this morning? Sing loud. Sing it out. Sing from your heart. And let's see what God will do.
this moment, can you, if you are a prayer, can you think of what you have witnessed? Maybe it's yesterday, maybe it's in the last week or month or year. Bring it to mind, because that's how we keep in our hearts who Jesus is, who our big God is, by reminding us. This is what testifying or witnessing is. Maybe you'd like to share that with someone after the service. Just say, hey, this is what came to mind. Because when we share what God has done, we build that community. We build faith in each other. We build hope that our prayers will come to fruition. Let's do that after the service. Have a seat, Door of Hope. It's great to see you today. And I want to talk about what we have witnessed in our 40 days of prayer thus far. For those that have been journeying with us, we're about halfway through. We're almost up to day 20. And some of you have been joining us online, and we've loved seeing you. Some of you have been joining us in person. Some of you have been reading with us or working through the daily devotions that we've been getting. And some of you have been just journeying through John 15 with us. Thank you for coming on the journey, and it's exciting. There's some things that we've witnessed. We've been praying for our three strategic goals: to know people, to embrace authenticity, and to engage in our digital community. And this past week, we've seen three funerals that we've been engaging with in our community. Two here in Launceston, one in Malaysia. And members of our Door of Hope family have been grieving. There may have been more. There might have been a funeral I don't know about. But we have seen answered prayer. And we've seen our community support in prayer in really beautiful ways. And God has answered amazing prayers. We've witnessed God's provision this week. That's the second thing that we've been praying for in our 40 days of prayer, that God would continue to provide. One of our prayers had this beautiful picture of God's hand of provision above us, ready to pour out. And He has. It's a story we'll bring you later, because it's still a story that's been working out. But God has provided miraculously already, in the order of hundreds of thousands of dollars, Door of Hope. And we get to tell the story, I hope, soon. But He has been providing. And our last one is that we want to abide in Jesus. As we read through John 15 and listen to Him talk about the fact that He is the vine and we are the branches, and when we abide in Him and listen to His commands and obey them, there's fruit. We saw our kids on our Tuesday and Thursday night dinner time prayer praying for the fruits of the Spirit in each other and thanking God for that. We've seen our young adults gather and tell stories of how their abiding in Jesus has brought amazing transformation. All the generations have been part of our 40 days of prayer. Our seniors and our little kids, Eleanor over here, praying in our group. It's been amazing. We've seen great answers to prayer, and there'll be more. But do you know what? As well as the answers to prayer, there's been things going on in us as prayers. Am I right? I've had provision this week. A job that I finished a year and a half ago, the EBA was completed, and I got back pay for my salary back there. It just popped into my bank account, and I'm like, God, that's amazing. I wasn't expecting that. And He brought this beautiful blessing just in time for school holidays. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Right? But when we intercede for others and pray on their behalf, God builds our faith. Thanks, Craig, for reminding me of that. Jesse, do you want to come up? If you want to engage in 40 days of prayer, our website has a page, 6 a.m. and 8 p.m. we pray via Zoom, 12 noon in our prayer room here. And then on Thursdays at 6 p.m. and Tuesdays, we do a little 10-minute family prayer. Please join us. We'd love for you to continue in this 40 days of prayer with us.
No, absolutely. Absolutely. And I do have to say one thing for anyone who decides they would like to go looking for Christy's mystery sermon that I talked about earlier. It wasn't Christy who started the series. It was Sandy. So go and listen
to
Sandy.
We look so alike.
I know, you and Sandy. Twins. Could be twins. No, absolutely. But speaking of those 40 days in prayer, prayer is so important. And I know I've been the beneficiary of so many prayers and prayer chains and things like that. So prayer is available after this service. So if you have something you would like prayer for, if you would like someone to intercede for you, or you feel like you need to intercede for someone else, please come and pray. There'll be some wonderful people up the front, or even if you want to stay in your seats and pray. We've also got Pack the Pantry coming up for this Mother's Day. So you can collect a tub or a bag and fill it with some non-perishable foods for our emergency pantry. There's a table out in the foyer, so please make sure you do that and bring it back on Mother's Day so we can bless those people in our community who are in need. We've also got Welcome to Door of Hope this morning in the foyer straight after the service. So please make sure, especially if you are new to our church, come and see that. You can hear all about who we are and what we're about. Come back tonight. We've got our youth service, our 5 p.m. service, and they'll be continuing a different series called The Devil and His Lies, and you'll be hearing from Winnie, who's always incredible to hear from. So 5 p.m. tonight, make sure you come back. Also, next week, we're going to be hearing from Dorothy, and I have double-checked and triple-checked. It is Dorothy we're going to be hearing from. So please come back next week and hear from Dorothy. This is an amazing series, and I know I'm getting a lot out of it and our 40 days of prayer. So maybe we shouldn't.
It's quarter past, which means parents.
Yes.
Could you please go straight away and collect your kids from HDK? That would be fabulous. Mel would be very, very appreciative of you doing that. And yeah, go well, everyone. If you'd like prayer, pop your hand up. We can come to you. Have a blessed week.